Hi friends, welcome to the presentation on theories of failure. Theories of failure is an important topic in machine design. Theories of failure means here we will refer theories of elastic failure. We know that machine components are designed to take loads. So when a machine component is subjected to load, then stresses are developed in it. So due to stresses, the material, the component will elastically deform. Basically, there are two types of deformation: elastic deformation and plastic deformation. In the case of elastic deformation, when the load is removed, the material regains its shape. Whereas in the case of plastic deformation, there is a permanent deformation after removing the load. So basically here we will only discuss about static loads. The failure of machine component under fluctuating loads is totally different. So that is covered in fitting. You know that machine components are designed to take complex loads. We need to predict the criteria of failure under complex loads. If you are able to find the criteria of failure under complex loads, then we can use that data to design a component such that it can take the load safely. So theories of failure is basically about these. We can predict the failure of a component under complex loads. And if we know how the component fails, then we can arrive at a design such that the material can safely take the load. So that is all about the theories of failure. Theories of failure is normally concerned with static loads, whereas fluctuating loads or alternating loads, in that case we will go for fitting. So the approach is totally different in the case of fitting, and the mode of failure is totally different. So before going into the theories of failure, first we will see what is failure. So failure is nothing but the failure of a load member can be regarded as any behavior that renders it unsuitable for its intended function. So basically, if you are having a machine component is subjected to complex loads. So due to the applied loads, there is a stress acting on the component, and we know that if the stress exceeds a particular value, then the material will start to deform. So basically, in the case of machine elements, we will go for ductile materials. On contrast, we are having brittle materials. So ductile materials show a region of plastic deformation before failure, whereas brittle materials, the failure is abrupt. When the component is loaded, initially it will undergo elastic deformation. And when the yield point is exceeded, the component will be plastically deformed. When the component deforms, the size of the component, the geometry of the component will change. Its function gets compromised by this deformation. Reliability of the component also will get changed, will get downgraded. In extreme cases, fracture also will take place. So fracture is nothing but the separation of the component into two or more pieces. So any behavior that renders its function unsuitable is basically a failure. Ductile materials. So ductile materials, first it will elastically deform, then it will go for, after that it will be plastically deformed, and finally it will get fractured. So all these modes of deformation, whether it is elastic or plastics, the dimension of the component is changing. So the dimension of the component changes. It is unfit to perform the desired function. So in that case, it is considered to be a failure. So in these theories of failure, basically we will deal with the ductile materials. So ductile materials show plastic deformation before failure. Initially, in the case of ductile materials, we are having a elastic deformation, then a plastic deformation, and finally your fracture. So theories of failure are basically applicable for ductile materials. Theories of failure discussed here are applicable only for elastic failures. You know that the stress in the actual machine component is complex. Examples of these complex state of stress can be seen in power screws. So power screw is under a torsional moment as well as an axial force. Another example is shaft. Shaft is under torsional moment, sometimes under bending and axial thrust also. Another example is bolt. So bolts, which are used to fasten a bracket, is under tensile stress and shear stress. We know that to determine the material properties, we will normally use a tension test. So in the case of tension test, the specimen is under uniaxial tension, and we can get the mechanical properties from the tension test, such as yield point, ultimate tensile strength, then personal elongation. So personal elongation is basically a measure of ductility of the material. We need to predict the failure of a machine component under complex state of stress. We have the mechanical properties determined from the tension test. We need to establish a relationship between the data obtained from the tension test to estimate the failure criteria of the machine component under complex state of stress. So in the case of theories of failure, what we will do is we will try to find a relationship between the strength of machine component under complex loads or stresses with the mechanical properties that you obtain from the tension test. So once you find out the criteria of failure for complex state of stress, then we can design the component. In other words, to arrive at the dimensions. In other words, if you are able to find out the criteria of the failure, then we can estimate the dimensions of the component. Or in other words, you can design it such that it will take the load safely. So that is all about theories of failure. So several theories have been proposed. Each theory assumes a different hypothesis of failure. The important theories of failure are as follows. Examples are maximum principle, stress theory, that is Rankine's theory, maximum shear stress theory, that is Coulomb, Guest, also known as Truska's theory. Third one is maximum principle strain theory, also known as Saint-Mirren theory. Fourth one is maximum total strain energy theory, also known as Hague's theory. Fifth one is maximum distortion energy theory, also known as Huber, von Mises and Henke theory. Out of these theories, the ones which give accurate prediction of the failure are maximum shear stress theory and maximum distortion energy theory. Among these, maximum distortion energy is most accurate. The proposed criteria is exactly matching the experimental values. If you want to design a component in a conservative manner, then you can go for maximum shear stress theory. Now we will explain the first one, that is maximum principle stress theory. This theory is also known as Rankine's theory. So this theory says that the failure of a mechanical component under biaxial or triaxial stress occurs and the maximum principle stress reaches the yield or ultimate strength of the material. As I have mentioned, we can use either ductile materials or brittle materials for designing a machine component. In the machine components normally encountered, you will go for ductile materials. So ductile materials, as I mentioned, exhibits yield strength and ultimate tensile strength, whereas brittle materials, these materials will fail abruptly, so there is only fracture strength, and these materials show negligible plastic deformation. You know that the principal stresses in the case of two dimensions, we are having two of them, that is sigma 1 and sigma 2, whereas for a 3D case we are having three of them, that is sigma 1, sigma 2 and sigma 3. So these are the normal stresses which are maximum, and in these planes there are no shear stresses. So that is known as principal stress. So as per Rankine's theory or maximum principal stress theory, material failure take place when the maximum principal stress reaches the yield point, or you can write sigma 1 is the yield strength of the material, that is sigma 1 is equal to SYT. So if you take the principal stress, you can arrange the principal stress in descending order. Sigma 1 is greater than sigma 2, greater than sigma 3. So we are referring to a 3D case. So sigma 1 is highest, then sigma 2, and then sigma 3. So if we are using a ductile material, the failure will take place when sigma 1 is equal to yield point. And if we are using a brittle material, then the failure will take place when the maximum principal stress, that is sigma 1 is equal to your ultimate strength of the material. So this is the criteria of failure as per maximum principal stress theory. Now we can extend this theory to estimate or determine the size of the component, or in other words, you can design or you can arrive at the size of the component. So that is the basically design. So the machine component have to take the stress without failure. So in this case, the principal stress that should be limited to some value. That value is given by the factor of safety. So sigma 1 is equal to Sy by factor of safety. So the maximum principal stress, we are not going to your failure level. You are limiting the maximum principal stress to a lower value. That is given by yield point by factor of safety. That is for ductile materials. Whereas for brittle materials, here we can limit the maximum principal stress to your ultimate tensile stress divided by factor of safety. Normally, for all materials, the tensile stress will be equal to compressive stress. Or you can write, using the compressive stress as a criteria, sigma 1 is equal to Sy S suffix yc, that is yield strength in compression by factor of safety. Or in other words, you can write, that is for ductile material. For brittle materials, you can write sigma 1 is equal to the ultimate tensile strength in compression by factor of safety. So that is regarding the maximum principal stress theory. So we will continue this theory in the next presentations. So these are the references I have made. Thank you.